Welcome to the finals at the ZOTAC Cup Monthly Final. Our final series, a best of three between the Sandwich Monkeys, their last appearance, and Epsilon Esports. Actually, like, for a long time we thought that Sandwich Monkeys would disband right after End of the Storm, but they kind of forgot that they were also qualified for the ZOTAC Cup Monthly Final, so they are still playing, and they made it all the way into the Grand Final. Zagara banned, and now the only question, Zulban, yes or no? That's the only question that we really have here, because so far both of these teams played the hero once, and, well, he was played two times today, and that's 100% win ratio right there, because both of the games were in the end won by the team that played Zul, even though it was also the favorite team that played the hero. So the Sandwich Monkeys have to consider all of that. They, of course, were able to watch the last game as well, so they have a bit of an idea of what Epsilon is doing. But are they going to ban him out, yes or no? The Zagara ban, on the other hand, of course, like, more or less a given, considering that we're on Sky Temple right now, and the bot lane is definitely one of the lanes where Zagara can unfold all of her strength and really push that back quite heavily. Oftentimes, in this case, we have Zagara completely split solo at the bottom, whereas the mid lane and the top lane being rotated around with four heroes, or you have a bit of split there as well. But we could also see bans. I mean, there's a couple of other heroes that you could... Ooh, an Asmodan ban! All right, so already changing things up a little bit. We have seen occasionally Epsilon play with an Asmodan. They actually used on Katowice and Blackheart's Bay Asmodan as well. So apparently they've been scrimming with this too. And Sandwich Monkeys definitely with a target ban here. Asmodan is a hero that a lot of the teams are talking about again. A lot of the teams are using him in scrims every now and then, and we've seen Epsilon win a map with Asmodan, as far as I know, in Katowice in the group stage at the regional finals. But yeah, Sandwich Monkeys must have some scrim knowledge there. They ban out Asmodan on Sky Temple. That allows Epsilon, that is definitely going to allow Zul. I mean, I would be very surprised to not see the hero right now, considering that he was first picked in a few of the games already earlier. But that definitely shows that the Sandwich Monkeys know exactly who they are playing against. So Asmodan banned out, and Epsilon is actually biding their time. There's still a couple of very nice first picks here available. I mean, consider, for example, Li Ming. Consider a Rega that is still very highly prioritized by the European teams. It's one of those European meta things. He is still one of the best healers, even though Blizzard has changed a few others now as well. Also, Thrall, oftentimes taken. We've seen both of the Bruisers, actually, Thrall and Sonya, being highly prioritized, depending on the map, quite a bit. So, yeah, Epsilon is once again running down the time pool quite heavily at that. Boys? Alright. That could... Time pool down at zero. Nothing happens. That's interesting. Apparently, yeah, there's... Okay, so I got a new draft. Okay. I got a new draft. Let's see what that does. All right, everybody. So we are back to the draft. We have a new draft, since the draft before was actually apparently a little bit buggy. And, well, in this case, we have Sky Temple. It is the first game in a best of three series between, in this case, Epsilon Esports and the Sandwich Monkeys. Falstad has been banned out, and so has Zul. I was already excited in the wrong draft, because we actually saw a ban on Asmodan there. And I know that Epsilon played a couple of games with Asmodan in Katowice, on a different map, though. And therefore, it looked a bit like Sandwich Monkeys has some internal scrim knowledge that they used for a target ban on the map. So with Epsilon, it's always like one of these things where you can actually see pretty crazy drafts every now and then. But in this case, as is, we have a bit more of a normal draft, because I was already surprised that Zul was neither banned out nor picked right away. In this case, though, our correct draft version, where the teams are actually like putting their time in, we have Zul banned, a hero that has been played by both of these teams already over the course of the tournament today. And so far, Zul has 100% win ratio. Sandwich Monkeys playing with Li Ming here as their first pick, and Epsilon Esports, they go for Rega early on. Now, Zagara is another hero that we could actually see taken at some point here. I'm not quite sure if Epsilon is going to commit to her this early, but she's of course amazing on the bot lane if you want to play with her here. She gets incredible pressure on the lane as is, and good vision around the boss, for example, as well. The safety alone that you have, that you know always where your opponent is positioned around the boss so that they can't sneak them in, makes Zagara really worthwhile. And if she's able to snipe the well at the bot lane, that's also like a pretty huge asset there. But for now, they're going for a Grey main instead, which is also a very good decision. Even though Greymane got nerfed a bit when it comes to the cocktail damage, his auto attacks are now a little bit stronger, and overall he's of course an incredible damage dealer still, and very highly prioritized in the European scene. The Sandwich Monkeys with Li Ming already. They have actually like now a couple of things that they can add to that roster. We've seen the Sandwich Monkeys overall with a high focus on ETC as well. They can do that again here on the map if they really want to. I mean, it's a lot about like zoning and peeling for Li Ming, trying to get a couple of kills in with potential snipes, and then of course allowing her to get the resets. And then early Karazim here already. And yeah, that Karazim is actually incredibly early if you think about it. So I'm a bit curious to see how the Sandwich Monkeys are going to play this here. Maybe they were a bit afraid that Epsilon would ban out Karazim as a support hero, but with Uther still being around, I could have seen them just simply go for Uther then instead. As is though, it is the Karazim and Sonya combo, which means that Zagara is still up for grabs. We have a Thrall that could be banned out by the Sandwich Monkeys if they don't want to risk going up against a Thrall, considering that they already picked Sonya here. So of course has quite a bit of like burst damage in the sense that she can just simply hit the spear and then get the slams in. And Wrath of the Berserker, even though it got a cooldown increase, is still a very powerful tool. Epsilon could ban out a frontliner. So for Epsilon, it's actually like one of those scenarios where they could have banned a frontliner quite easily. They could, for example, say, all right, we want to make sure that they are not going to run an ETC here. Muradin also very popular with Sonya. Both of the heroes can basically slide or jump in, get the additional stun on top of it. Epsilon, on the other hand, has the next two picks, so it means that they will also get an opportunity to pick one of those frontliners away if they want to. With Falset banned out, a lot of the global presence is already gone, and as expected, there is a ban on one of the frontliners. So Muradin is banned out, which makes it kind of likely that Epsilon, I actually wanted to say, goes into an ETC, which I still think is a great choice, but considering the ban and pick pattern that we've seen from Epsilon in the last few games, they seem to actually like value Diablo even a little bit more, and also like that Diablo Johanna that they picked before, that seemed to be really more their style. We have seen in the first game Stalk still with that ETC, so Epsilon plays it, but I don't really feel like it had that huge impact that they were hoping for, and they played against the weaker team at that point. So it's a bit too early to tell. I'm not really sure what Epsilon is going to go for right now. But yeah, we have still 3-4 very, very strong frontliners to choose from. Already a ban on Abathur. And I mean, Abathur was already played in one of the earlier games by Epsilon where they decided to go for the copy on Greymane. And I suppose on a map like Sky Temple, it's actually like a good choice to get rid of this. If you know that your opponent is leaning towards playing a double Grey main and likes to go for that split soak with an Abathur, then on Sky Temple banning him out is probably not the worst idea. Abathur can be very annoying if Falstad is already eliminated because you just can't simply chase him down wherever you see him. Epsilon then again, first of all, frontline is definitely needed. And besides that, it would probably help them to really think about that Thrall as well. I mean, oftentimes when we see Sonya on one side, we are immediately seeing a Thrall being picked and the other way around because you have the two bruisers going up against each other. There's that ETC. All right, now the only question, is it going to be comboed off with a Thrall? Are we going to see something along the lines of a Diablo, maybe? If they don't go for a Thrall, then double frontline would definitely still be a good choice. The Sandwich Monkeys will, of course, pick a full-fledged tank at the front. And therefore, Epsilon would do well to decide and play a second melee hero as well. And if you go into the Thrall, then you can still go a Sundering and can try to combo a Mosh Pit off with that. So that's still an opportunity that you have. We could also see, of course, that Jaina still. But no, it's a Vala. Vala, of course, has been changed as well. The multi-shot build is not as strong as it was before. And we have seen different styles on Vala already, but that auto-attack build in particular with the Manticore is going to be a bit stronger. Like, the trait is stronger on her. That helps, of course, with the auto-attacks. Then you can go into Manticore, which has increased damage output now as well. So, and especially Reign of Vengeance. Reign of Vengeance has so much damage now. But it all means that you have to actually go in a bit deeper. Like, before that, you could really stay in the back and could get multi-shots out the entire time. And you stay at a safe distance, you get good damage in. Right now, you have actually to commit a bit more to the battle itself, get closer into auto attack range, and also get the Reign of Vengeance in. Which makes Vala a bit, I would say she is a little bit more scary at this point, but also she's not as safe as she was before. So you have to play a bit more careful on her. With this being said, the Sandwich Monkeys decided to play this with a Johanna. So Johanna together with Sonya is being played. Muradin wasn't an option for them. I suppose, well, there's actually like very few choices that would have been really viable for them. and the Thrall being taken too. Wow. So now that Epsilon decided against Thrall, the Sandwich Monkeys say, like, you know what? We are actually like in a scenario right now where we run that double front, that triple, quadruple frontline, if you consider that Charism as well, together with Li Ming in the back. And think about the level 16 talent on Charism right now. You get so much heal now out of the Circle of Life as your talent, which is a bit insane. And the interrupts are there as well. I mean, ETC might actually, in this case, simply go into stage dive. Because let's face it, if you look at ETC mosh pit, there's an interrupt on more or less any hero there at the front line. On Thrall, on Johanna, and on Sonya as well. So he needs to be super careful. The threat of a mosh pit might force a few of the heroes to hold their cooldowns back. But besides that, you could play that with a stage dive. Has been played in the past. Well, at this point right now, on the other hand, we are still seeing a very solid setup for the Sandwich Monkeys, with the final pick on Epsilon being Zeratul, which we've also seen before. Very scary for Li Ming, actually. Zeratul is going to make that quite scary, but Li Ming should actually be kind of safe, considering that she has so many heroes that help her out here. Even Foresight could be used on level 4. I don't really expect it for the Sandwich Monkeys. I don't really feel that Sport Billy is going to go for the talent, but if you feel that you have to detect Zeratul, that it would be a good choice. Either way, this is going to be a pretty cool game here. Very melee heavy setup for the Sandwich Monkeys. Epsilon also with a good setup. Personally, I'm very curious to see how exactly Vala is going to be used in this game right now. I'm pretty sure that we're going to see at least Reign of Vengeance. As is, though, we're going to jump in, ladies and gentlemen. Our first game here at the Grand Final at the ZOTAC Cup Monthly Final between Epsilon Esport and the Sandwich Monkeys. Game number one, ladies and gentlemen, at the ZOTAC Cup Monthly Final Grand Final. The best of three series is kicking off with a game on Sky Temple. And to the left side of the map, we're having Team Epsilon with Stork on ETC, Styr on Zeratul, Unstable on Rega. We're seeing Greymane on, played by Sfixi, and Andy Lendi is playing Vala. To the right side of the map, ADRD on Li Ming. We're currently seeing the Sandwich Monkeys with Anti-Hero on Thrall, Sport Billy on Charism, and BKB on Johanna, and Zarmany on Sonya. So a heavy melee setup that we have for the team in red. And yeah, I already said it a bit earlier, but I really would love to see a leap on Sonya, considering that the cooldown of, well, Wrath of the Berserker was increased. And of course, they have Sundering into Leap, into Blessed Shield, which just sounds dirty as hell. And you all know I like dirty things. Stalk already down. Yeah, well, I like it dirty, and with a leap, that would be exactly what we need here. Already, we're having the Siphoning Arrow taken on the side of Vala. Of course, we expect her to go straight into that renewed Reign of Vengeance, which does now so much more damage. Vala, in general, is now being forced to play a bit more into melee range, since especially the multi-shot build has been nerfed in the last patch. It doesn't really do as much damage anymore. Blizzard reasoning was actually, like, very smart. I mean, they've been talking about how they feel that right now the strongest build on Vala is the multi-shot build, and it's by far the safest as well. So they wanted to just, like, balance it out a little bit, and I feel it was really a decent change. Even though I love to play multi-shot on her, I have to agree, it was a bit too safe of a build, and right now it just feels a little bit better for that. That being said, though, we have, in this case, already block taken on Thrall, and with such a melee-heavy setup, especially Charism, is going to do a lot. It also explains why Charism was picked this early in the draft, because apparently from the get-go, the Sandwich Monkeys were theorizing about going into a Charism play here, so that they could go mass melee. We have Styr and Anti-Hero at the bot lane, so Zeratul laning against Thrall. Oftentimes, of course, Zeratul later on is going to try and roam through the map, but for now, until he gets a couple of talents in, it makes sense to keep him at the bot lane here to try and act as a counterpart or counterweight against Thrall. We already have the first temple by Unstable. Well, he's just like trying to get a few of those, but BKB is there, Sport Billy, they're not jumping in just yet. In terms of talent, nothing really too surprising. I mean, if you think about it, especially Greymane's auto attack damage being increased a little bit, and Vala, of course, also having a bit more of a focus on the auto attack, it makes sense to switch it up and go for block instead. Yeah, block on not only Thrall, but also on Sonya. It's an even exchange with the temples at this point. Level 4 is going to hit roughly for the two teams at the same time now. And Rega up to the top lane, jumping in here. Puncturing arrow now taken after the siphoning arrow. Oh, unstable. Needs to be very careful. He's the healer here, needs to keep himself in the back a little bit. Warple Blades already on the side of Zeratul here to try and connect to the back line in particular. And an adjustment for anti-hero as well, with a Thrall going straight into the Spirit Journey. Which is a very annoying talent, by the way. If you are chasing someone down, that is so annoying. And in this case, he's not going for the Chain Lightning poke anyway, so that level 4 talent is more or less in a free talent where he can just like get something else, and that wolf is super, super scary. So Zarmini is already there, is starting to join up at the top to kill against Johanna. Well done, Sphinxy is a bit low, but Thrall was still at the bot lane, and all of a sudden this fight was turned into a 5v4. It also means that anti-hero has a bit of time at the bot lane to really take one of the towers down. He's not able to really get the damage in yet, but at least he's able to damage one of the towers at least a little bit. Pressure play in the mid lane, on the other hand, where Steer and Andilendi are trying to force Zarmini back successfully at that. We have, in terms of experience, still a lead for the red team, though, because of anti-hero soaking experience at the bot lane. You might look at that kill on Johanna at the top and say, oh my god, yeah, they got a kill, totally worth it. But if you give up lane experience because of it, then you are all of a sudden taking a very bad trade. Because as long as that Johanna is not on a solo lane and you lose or your opponent loses experience there, they're actually in a bit of a better spot. You can see it at the experience bars. They're very much the same at this point. And that kill didn't really matter at all. Anti-hero is already here at the bot lane. They have an extra camp now, which puts more pressure onto the lane as well. And both teams are, of course, now aiming for level 7, which is reached a bit faster by the sandwich monkeys. We're having full cooldown reduction build, by the way, on Johanna, going for battle momentum and eternal retaliation here. So for both of them, on level 7, the Stone Wolves now increased as well with a root increase. So that is really a lot of lockdown that they're looking at this point. And at the same time, repeating arrow being chosen for Vala. So the build definitely is being influenced here for Vala. She is being played very differently, multi-shot not as strong anymore. Once again, Sport Billy and Anti-Hero moving in. And actually one of the reasons why we're seeing Vala being played a little bit more often is also that with the Reign of Vengeance, you're having incredible damage now in addition to the stun. Because before that, Reign of Vengeance was basically a tool that most of the Vala players just used when they needed a stun. That double stun is very powerful, especially on a map like Cursed Hollow, for example, but if you now get also a lot of damage out of it, then if you hit that properly, then it's of course great. And let's face it, hitting a good Reign of Vengeance can be kind of annoying. I mean, hitting the first wave, yeah, it's pretty easy, but like locking it down perfectly so that you get value out of both waves, that's a completely different matter though. Sport Billy up at the top here, Temple announced at the bottom, already a bit of a pressure play in the mid lane where Stork has to be careful against two, but the top lane is still being contested as that camp is pushing in. And this is actually like a very heavy push here. They give up the bot lane to a certain extent, only Thrall is there fighting against Zeratul, ETC is making his way down now as well, but up at the top two heroes still have to take care of the remainders of this bruiser camp. Unstable rushing away there. Personally, I'm really curious about the level 10s. I mean, we could see the Wrath of the Berserkers, the cooldown got increased by Blizzard a little bit, but Leap together with Sunring and also the Blessed Shield would just be absolutely phenomenal. And Sandwich Week is actually used Leap plus also Falling Sword in the past. Stier, lockdown rooted and taken down. Anti-heroes level 7 guaranteeing them a kill. If not for that, Zeratul could have easily blinked away, I suppose. But right now, they get the kill against Zeratul. Up at the top lane, we're having Unstable and Sphinxy already in position against Zarmini. They're trying to go for the fort. I'm already a set panda because we don't get a lead, we don't get war. Instead, we are just getting the Wrath of the Berserker, playing it old school style. Alright, Zarmini, I'll get it. No guts, no glory, my friend. Could have taken a bit of a risk there. I would have loved some Bombo Combo potential. But they're playing it safe. It's game number one after all. Already level 10 for both. And there is the Reign of Vengeance. Oh, the attempt. But Anti-Hero is reacting. They get the kill against ETC. And now they just move into the Void Prison. Brilliant play here by the Sandwich Monkeys. Extremely well done. But they're not out of the woods yet. Here comes BKB on the other hand. And they're getting the kill against Vala too. Great play. Wave of Force has been chosen once again, by the way, by ADRD here for his Li Ming. So this is starting to look better and better, actually, for the second chance. They're already a level ahead, and that is 4 kills against 1. Great play by them. and also anti-hero. I mean, the Duke that we just saw against, in particular, that Reign of Vengeance was absolutely great, and then afterwards they just turned it around against not only EDC, but they also eliminated Vala. Zeratul with the Void Prism was trying to section them off and isolate them, but that didn't really work out. So overall, incredible play here. We currently have, at the same time now, also a bit more pressure at the bot lane, thanks to the Siege Giant. There's also like a few taken by the opponent, but as you can already tell, they are bursted away within seconds. So that didn't really last too long. Same time though, we are having level 12 and a half right now. And already the move up to the top, where suddenly Zarmany is very much alone. Mosh pitted as well. You see Zarmany, he could have jumped away with a leap here. Kappa kappa. So next time, go leap or go home. Yeah, I mean, jokes aside, like, of course, totally understandable going into a Wrath of the Berserker, even with that cooldown increase. It's an amazing talent still. The leap that I was insisting on was just for my personal pleasure, because let's face it, Wombo combos are awesome. And especially a Sonya jumping through the map and just like yelling wah the entire time is super brilliant. BKB showing himself here, has to go up against Stuart Unstable right now. By the way, Unstable, of course, like on his Rhaegar, went straight into the totem on level 1. And we have him with a Feral Heart here on level 4. Now with 75% extra regeneration on hit points and mana. Not like the good old days where we had like 100%, that was the dream, but right now Blizzard realized that was just a little bit too much. Already at the top lane, Greymane is getting the soak from one of the temples, but down here it's time for the Sandwich Monkeys to reign supreme. So they're going to get at least like one temple, it's an even trade, but already the isolation against Li Ming over here. Everybody jumps in, AD Arty with a teleport, but there is Stalk as well. They really wanted her. Nah, Illusionist didn't really help too much here. We have, by the way, Wormhole now taken, Tidal Waves, and still on level 13, the Frost Shot for Vala. This is one of the cool things if you go for either an auto attack build or if you go for the arrow build. Then on level 13, you can go into the Spell Shield, you have the Frost Shot that you can still take if you want to have some control over the team fights, and especially against melee heavy setups. Frost Shot makes a lot of sense to get you a nice control there. Sundering used, and the immediately locked out and kill against Vala. But Johanna is dying too, and that was a good stun there. I actually think that the cooldown was still ready on the Iron Skin. Not 100% certain about that though, but in this case it's an even trade. Li Ming is starting to come back, and at the bottom, still a few of those shots are being soaked. Zeratul! Zeratul with the Ancestral Healing, kept alive thanks to Rhaegar. But Li Ming is there. Li Ming is about to go in, keep that wave of force in mind. But for now, no. Cooldown was still ready, though. Just to give you a bit of an idea about like damage at this point. Li Ming at 19,000, looking pretty solid here. We're having, in terms of damage, 17,000 on Vala. Mostly, of course, also thanks to the Reign of Vengeance, which was nicely used in at least one of the fights, even though earlier anti-hero, of course, like dodged it. But in this case, we have still the burst against Vala. And I mean, it's kind of what we expected after the draft already. Trying to go for Vala, trying to get the burst in, trying to just like lock it down with the stunts. And the Levy has to get in a bit closer, we know that now as well. The cool thing about the Frost Shot is also that you make it a bit easier for yourself to target your own heroic ability. If you want to lock down the Reign of Vengeance perfectly and you get a good slow in, then you oftentimes have a little bit more time to prepare that properly. For now though, the teams are both on very, very even experience. I mean, we're looking at level 15 versus level 15. Control on the map can be gained at this point by getting a few of the Siege Giants, but it's really just like a question of hitting the 16 soon enough, because with level 16, especially the red team is going to get some very powerful talents here, of course. It's also true for Rhaegar, I suppose, because he gets very nice lockdown, and Vala is going to get a bit more survivability. But if you think about Sonya's survivability here, about also like Johanna, about also the heal that we get from Charism, this is like one of the best spikes that you can get from her for now. And yeah, in this case, wow, that Void Prism. Stür, like seriously, he's a hero. Like, he just saved ETC's ass. That was definitely like, that was his doing. A four-man Void Prism. But once again, level 16, the Circle of Life, is going to be phenomenal for Charizard. Charizard, by the way, with Cleanse on level 7, we've been talking about the talent quite a bit. Now that Blizzard changed Charizard slightly, so that he gets more heal out of his basic heal, but doesn't have to rely on this level, on the Echo of Heaven on level 7 this heavily anymore, getting Cleanse in is a lot easier for Charizard than before. There's a lot of heroes that have Cleanse that can't really use it. Brightwing is a very good example, because Brightwing is depending so much on the shield build, on the face shield build, that you just can't give up the Hyper Shift on level 7. So for now, we have the Circle of Life taken, and that's really going to explode the healing power of Charizard. That's going to be amazing for him. Johanna is moving down after she put some pressure in up at the top lane thanks to the cooldown reduction. We're now also having on 16 Tempest Fury after the Grace of Air. And here comes Nerves of Steel and also all the time that we've been talking about a bit earlier. Rending Cleave, by the way, on Zeratul. We have once again on the Alpha Killer taken now as well. They're jumping in. Unstable heals himself. Barely kept alive. Sundering already used. They're going for Greymane once again. Blown away by AD Ahri already. Wave of Force not used yet. They're trying to jump in again. And in this case, also Vala not hitting her ult. That really showcases that it's a lot harder to hit that Reign of Vengeance probably than to simply execute a strafe during one of those battles where you can keep yourself in the backline. On level 13, on the prowl with the movement speed, no unfettered assault here, and the Alpha Killer against all those melee heroes here with their hit point pool. Sport Billy is already there. Here's a little bit of a poke happening right now. Level 16 talents. In this case, Vala went straight into the blood for blood. We're having 17 versus 17. Now still very, very close when it comes down to the setup here in experience. Anti-hero is waiting. Cooldowns, most of them are still not ready. Blessed Sheet will be though. Mosh Pit is as well. Blessed Shield is ready. Wave of Force now too. And keep in mind, oh, there we are already. Oh, Wave of Force being used. Very low cooldown, by the way, on the Talon, of course, as well. So Wave of Force is helping in these situations as well. The cool thing is, of course, that with Wave of Force now in play, we have a massive amount of interrupts against the Mosh Pit. This is one of the reasons why I said that Stalk could have gone into Stage Dive. I wouldn't have blamed to go for a Stage Dive here. Would have, of course, required a bit of a different playstyle from ETC, but they could have tried to just, like, get some Split Soak on the other end of the map, and that would have helped them. There's way too many interrupts right now. We have 4 interrupts against ETC's Mosh Pit at this point. Really easy interrupts as well. So, for now, it's still them just, like, trying to find an opportunity to go in, and BKB is attempting to flank right now. Here's the Condemn. He has also... There's the Sundering and the blow against 2. The kill against Anilendi. Yeah! Yes, they get it. Wave of Force is still available, by the way, but now we could see boss. I mean, you can pressure the bot lane right now. Call has been made, though, to go for boss instead. 5 versus 3. Definitely the chance that they've been waiting for. They don't push the bot lane, but they try to snipe this one. And I mean, they still have at least Divine Palm, and the Wave of Force is ready now once again too. But Void Prism is on cooldown, Mosh Pit is not though, but of course they don't risk it. I mean, it's still a 5 versus 3, you don't want to run in here. The worst case scenario is that you lose another hero or two, and then you lose the boss as well, and all of a sudden your core is even threatened. In this case, they can still defend against the boss. Of course, they will lose quite a few hit points here at the bot lane, at least the wall. But in this case, they can still defend against it. Depends a little bit on if one of their heroes is maybe a bit too far out and can be isolated. Yeah, Antir is already trying, but he's a little bit too optimistic with that. Also, Void Prism is ready once again, so Stier could move in from the back and try to isolate them. That's exactly what he does. Moves in. Here comes the Ancestral Healing, but the Void Prism, and nice combo with the Mosh Pit. Interrupts is a little bit late, but everybody's still alive, and now they're starting to chase. They're jumping in against Stalk. Zeratul moved in and moved out. He's very low on mana though, so he won't be able to do too much. And 2 temples are active on the map once again. The wall is gone. No hero died in that encounter. And level 19 and a half is just once again showcasing how strong the Sandwich Monkeys are right now. They are rotating from lane to lane, getting a bit more experience. The dream for them, of course, would be to hit level 20 before they go for the shots. And currently, that's exactly what they're aiming for. Just like soak a little bit, move away. They don't want to fight. Why would they? They want to go for the level 20. They want to make sure that they get a chance there. But I feel it's a bit too far away, and they seem to agree here. They understand that they can't just simply give that up, and that's why they move in immediately to push the opponent back. And it seems like Epsilon is not willing to fight either. Since Zeratul is at the bot lane, they would have been forced into a 5 versus 4, and that's something that they just simply cannot afford. Level 20 after just another structure kill is going to be ready for the team in red, and there we have it. And that is going to give them the chance to really just like snipe another hero here. Especially Rhaegar is very much alone. Rhaegar attacked and taken down. Goodbye. No chance for him. Absolute like dominant position right now for the Sandwich Monkeys. Way too strong. And they're seeing Stalk. They're seeing Stalk, and Anti-Hero jumps in, tries to lock him down. Andy Landy is attempting to just like have his back, but yeah. 20, by the way, not taken yet on Li Ming. Li Ming without the level 20 just yet. Also soon gonna be ready for Team Epsilon. We have the 20 now for them, and that's a rewind. That's also Bolt of the Storm for Vala. We're probably gonna see another Bolt of the Storm for ETC now, with a Hunter's Blunderbuss taken. for Greylane. And there's the Storm Shield. No rewind for Rhaegar. Instead, the Storm Shield against those Wombo combo potential that we are seeing here. ADRD needs to be careful here. It's rather low. He went for Tal Rushers, by the way, on level 20. And ETC still not going for the choice. I mean, he could go for the Turbos here, which you occasionally see. Sometimes you get amazing value out of it. But still, Bolt of the Storm is the go-to talent on ETC, and for good reason. Jumping in with a quick blink and then hitting the mosh pit is always scary as hell. BKB has to move away here now too. Keep in mind that none of these keeps have fallen. No keep has fallen just yet. So we have a lot of keeps, like, heavily damaged on the side of Epsilon. But none of them has fallen yet. Here comes the Bolt of the Storm. Stalk goes in. Not falling for the mosh pit just yet. And BKB is still alive. They go for the camp and all's good in the hood. Once again, rotating around. 47,000 damage on Mimic. When it comes to, like, look at that siege damage, by the way, on the side of Greymane. And keep in mind that Greymane's cocktail damage and AoE damage already got a little bit nerfed, but he's still at 136,000 damage against siege. So that wave clear is insane. 109,000 on Johanna went into a cooldown reduction build. And a bit of a trap set up at the bottom here. Let's see if they're going to fall for it. Nope, already poking. They see BKB. Here comes the totem. They're starting to move in. And immediately the Void Prison. Void Prison has been used. ETC wants to go for the mosh pit. Nope, he doesn't get the chance to do that. And Andy Landy also missing the wave a bit. Everybody moving away. Bubble wipe. That was the idea here. Use the mosh pit next to the Void Prison. Use the Rain of Vengeance and just wipe everything that was trapped by the Void Prison, by the bubble. It didn't work out for them. A lot of cooldowns have been committed. Both of the teams are missing two. And Void Prism, of course, was one of the most important ones. Stur on his Zeratul hit the Void Prism, but then BKB was not affected by it, and he immediately started to use his Condemn and time it in a way that ETC's mosh pit would have been interrupted, and he did very well at that. Allowed the rest of the team to jump out so they did not get affected by the Rain of Vengeance, nor by the mosh pit that wasn't even used at that point because Stalk already decided it would be too much of a risk, and he didn't want to have it back in the cooldown. So for now, it's still like posturing around a bit. Blessed Shield is about to be ready, so with the Blessed Shield they can start to move in again. Already, it's like, yeah, a bit of an exchange in tempo shots here. Bot lane is still being pressured. One keep down up at the top towards the blue team. They lost their first one. 9 kills against 4 overall, but one team fight can decide the entire game right now. Sonya is there. Zarmany is on the move. Is starting to look if he can jump in from the side and flank. ADRD under a lot of pressure here. All of the cooldowns are ready. Void Prison isn't though. Here comes the Wrath of the Berserker. They're starting to jump in. Stalk is a bit far out. Needs to be careful here. Stur again looking for ADRD. BKB was on the spot on the temple getting a couple of the shots in. Already the Storm Shield has been used and they're trying to go in. Nice Condemn. Here comes the immediate Sundering, but the Ancestral Healing is ready. Once more the Mosh Pit. This time it's much better, but the damage is still missing. BKB is triggered. He is using his invincible here, and at the same time they attempt to go for Stalk, but he bolts away. Everybody is low. Lockdown against Rhaegar, but nobody dies, and they barely get away there. Go for the throat is finally ready as well, but they couldn't go for the kill here. So towards the left side, as you can see, first keep is down. They nearly were able to obliterate the one in the middle as well. One shot is all that was missing. And currently ADRD making sure that at least that Siege Giant kept towards the bottom of the map is not going to do anything either. But a bit of like shots up at the air starting to tickle the towers down now. And in the mid lane, that's a different story, of course. With those shots fired, keep number 2 is already gone. And suddenly we're seeing Epsilon under a lot of pressure here. Epsilon is in incredible bad spot. They need to make sure that they somehow fight against it. But Mosh Pit is off cooldown. We're having Wave of Force ready and Blessed Shield. The blue team is looking in a really, they're in a really tough spot at this point. They're having an amazing situation for the red team. Their cooldowns are coming off in 1 second or in 7 seconds. We're going to have Sundering back to business as well. The keep at the bot lane has been eliminated right now to immediately the attack against the core. It's not going to fall, but it's going to suffer damage. It's definitely going to be damaged, as you can see. There's another like 6-7 shots ready, and the core goes down to like maybe something like 80-75% at this point. Yep, 69 even. Boss is also on the map, and just like threatening boss and going for another trap is already going to be enough. Cooldowns are already, except for Wrath of the Berserker. Also, Mosh Pit is 20 seconds away, so as long as the Mosh Pit is ready, they can go for a fight here. Not quite sure if they know that though. Stalk is still there. He's in position and posturing around, but he will have his Mosh Pit up in a few seconds. So everybody is dancing away again. 22 minutes already on a Sky Temple, and it's game number 1 in the Grand Final. Game number 1. And you can really tell that one mistake, one lost team fight is going to eliminate you. And especially when you are in the shoes of the Sandwich Monkeys, one team fight means that you can lose the entire setup, especially with the mosh pit. Here we go. Again, they move out. Well played here. They are not getting hit by anything. Blessed Shield, nearly the kill against Shia, but he jumps away. And the totem being used to lock them down once more. But great play by the Sandwich Monkeys, getting not affected by the Rain of Vengeance. The mosh pit not there. And that was important. That was incredibly important. In this case, it really worked for them. Zeratul is in trouble. Here comes ETC interrupted. They interrupt on the mosh pit immediately. The kill against Zeratul. This could already be the Storm is jumping out of the ball of the Storm. And we immediately also see Fixie alone trying to jump in with a go for the Thor, but he's down. Double kill, triple kill. Rega is dead. Storm is trying to escape, but he's blasted away by the AWP. And now they can simply go for core. It's a quad kill. Here comes Zarmony. He wants Andy Landy, but they're definitely going to get the core. It's already at 38%. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is game number one in the grand final at the ZOTAC Cup Monthly Final. It is the Sandwich Monkeys with a 1-0 lead in the best of three series. Okay guys, game number two, Tomb of the Spider Queen is the map, and as you can see here, we have the Sandwich Monkeys going up against Epsilon Esports, and well, guess what, in this case, we're having the Sandwich Monkeys in the 1-0 lead after the Sky Temple game that we just saw. So, once again, the question is, of course, to be or not to be, not quite, but Zul or not to Zul. Is he going to be banned, yes or no? I personally would love if we could see him in the game again, but to be honest with you, with his wave clear, I highly doubt that they are going to let him go through the draft on Tomb of the Spider Queen because it's just a little bit too strong. Right now, Epsilon, they ban out. Okay, they ban out Li Ming. Apparently a little bit annoyed by the hero from the last game. No Zagara ban, no Rega ban, which we oftentimes see, and Zul is indeed banned. So, yeah, in this case, the Sandwich Monkeys make sure that Epsilon is not going to be able to pick him up as the first pick, which is a bit unfortunate for us, even though we got to see the hero at least twice already today. Yeah, for now, let's see. We have Epsilon actually in this case. Step in Razor. Don't do that. Resubbed for 2 months. Thanks, dude. So Epsilon in this case, I mean, like, okay, let's talk about Zagara. We can see a Zagara at the bot lane, very powerful hero here. We have still seen Falstead being played by a lot of the teams, even though on this map you don't really have as much of an impact as on a lot of the other maps, like Cursed Hollow, for example. But also Falstead has been played a little bit with that like more like caster build, not so much focused on the auto attack, but instead more of a focus on his actual abilities, which is exactly what Blizzard intended to. But as expected, it is Zagara. Not really a big surprise considering that she's just so strong. The thing is, I could see a Chen. Not now, later. I'm just saying it because we have Antihero currently playing for the Sandwich Monkeys. And he's incredibly good on Chen and also on Thrall. He's been playing Thrall for the team quite a bit now. So I feel like one of the two is going to be their choice to send up into the field against Zagara at the bot lane. And depending on the setup that they're trying to use, we could see a later, like a Chen later on in the game, or they are going to pick an early Thrall, one of the two. So that is probably going to be their counterplay against Zagara. But we're getting a little bit ahead of ourselves. So heroes that they could pick, first of all, Rega, of course, is a hero that I would still expect in that early double pick here. Together with Rega, you can then make the decision to go into Thrall. Yes, there he is. So Antihero is going to play Thrall, no Chen. A bit unlikely. One of the heroes that I want to point out a bit when we're talking about the Sandwich Monkeys is still Cho'Gall. Cho'Gall has been played by Mindsanity, by a few other teams as well, and also the Sandwich Monkeys a lot. And this is one of the best maps because you have easy rotations. A horrible map for Cho'Gall is, for example, Blackheart's Bay is not really great for him. Or, let's say, Dragonshire isn't really great because you need control over certain objective points on the map, and then having one less buddy in the game is oftentimes a bit of a liability, not really an asset. But with a lane so close together as in Tomb of the Spider Queen, you can make easy rotations happen with Cho'Gall. So it's one of the things that the Sandwich Monkeys have done. Rega, as expected, taken. And we could end up with a ban on Cho'Gall, which is actually exactly what we've seen in one of the earlier series where the Sandwich Monkeys played. We're getting, at this point, again, a little bit ahead of ourselves, though. So, Epsilon, talking about their options right now. First of all, we have them already with Zagawa, which is very powerful. When it comes to the front line, they can now think about like going into ETC, for example. So they could say, okay, we're going to go into that ETC again. We're going to try and make a similar play happen to what we've did in the last game. So, oh, they decide to go into the Johanna instead. So they can still combo that off with an ETC later, but it's, of course, a little bit less likely at this point. Gray main would be a great choice. They decide against him, on the other hand. Now, that is a bit of a surprise to me. They already head straight into that charism, so they can't be banned out. And interestingly enough, no gray main for them, which would allow the Sandwich Monkeys to pick up gray main if Epsilon does not ban him out right now. So there is, of course, still, like, if you see, for example, Leoric ban right now, then you can already tell that there is a high chance that we're actually going to see an attempt at least to go into Cho'Gall and would more or less force Epsilon's hand and ban Cho'Gall out, unless they are willing to take him on. But it is a Jaina ban instead. Jaina, of course, with Maw is a very nice follow-up where you can get incredible damage in, especially, of course, with Ring of Frost plus Blizzard. But for now, what does Epsilon ban out? I mean, there's a gray main to ban. If there is no Cho'Gall play from the Sandwich Monkeys, then I assume that we're actually going to see a gray main pick by them. I would be very surprised to not see that. So Epsilon has to kind of balance that out a little bit. Do they go for a ban on Cho'Gall? Would Sandwich Monkeys really consider playing him here? Or do they go for a ban on gray main, which would leave Cho'Gall, of course, open? Then Epsilon could still react with the Leoric as well to try and get a bit of counterplay in, or an Anubarak with Web Blast, which has been used a lot. But instead, they actually go into a Diablo ban. The reason for the Diablo ban is also quite obvious. In this case, it would be Apocalypse plus Sundering that they are afraid of. And now the Sandwich Monkeys have to make that choice. So either we're going to see Cho'Gall or we're going to see a Greyman. I would be very surprised if, like, both of those were false. I would be very, very... I would be shocked. But the Diablo ban definitely targeting towards that Thrall combo that we've seen a lot, where you just, like, start with the Sundering and you combo the Apocalypse off and you get a very nice stun lock where you can just, like, take a target apart. But right now, if it's not going to be a Cho'Gall, then Greyman is probably going to be chosen, and then it's a question of which tank do you want to play. The Sandwich Monkeys have the option to go still into ETC here. They have played Arthas in the past on this map. Syndragosa is very valuable here. But they go into... Okay, so they start things off with a Tassadar here. I'm still expecting a Grey main, but that is definitely starting to put a much higher focus on Thrall in particular. It gives you the option, of course, to use the Oracle against Zagara. You have also the Storm that can get tree tumors out. But I would still like to see that gray man here. They wait for a long, long time right now. Grayman has very, very nice wave clear, and I feel on this map in particular, he excels with that. And some kind of range damage poke is definitely needed. And if you don't go gray main, what else do you really pick at this point? Lunara it is! I was thinking for Lunara, but to be honest with you, like, I feel that Greymane might have been the better option here. Lunara is a hero that we oftentimes see with the Stitches in the European server, and we've seen Lunara played by Virtus Pro on this map a lot. I like Lunara, but I still feel that Greymane might have been the better choice here, but, well, then again, to be honest with you, Lunara can be very annoying in the back. Greymane has the advantage that his wave clear, I would say, is still a little bit better. I mean, of course, after the Thornwood Vines, Lunara can actually get quite a bit of wave clear out as well, and they have at least the Tassadar here that can help with that. But Greymane with that particular setup would have been pretty nice, because not only can you use your Ancestral and the Shield for Thrall, but if Greymane decides to jump in, you can actually use them for that too. Epsilon decides to go into a Sonya, which I personally like a lot as a counterweight to Thrall in the setup. Their last pick, I still feel they would need a bit more damage in this setup. So as Greymane is open, they could decide to go into Greymane. If they decide against that, I mean, in theory, you could even see a bit of an old-school style here going into a Sylvanas, which I don't think we're going to see. I don't think that's going to happen at all. But if you wanted to play that, you could. A false stat, indeed it is. It could actually be one of those games where we don't see a Greymane. I'm currently double-checking that he's not actually banned out. That happened to me in the past, that I was, like, insisting on a hero being picked, and it was actually, like, banned, and I completely overlooked it. But, yeah, so we don't see a Greyman. We need still a tank for the Sandwich Monkeys. They have the choice between Muradin, Stitches. Both of them could be used. If you go into Stitches it is. So, again, that combo that I talked about a bit earlier, that in the European scene, Stitches Lunara is very, very popular. But no Greyman. Very surprising to me. Very surprising that on a map like Tumulus Spire Queen, we don't see Greymane. The cocktail build got a bit nerfed. No questions about that. But still, as we could see in the last game, his output in of siege damage is still incredible. Lunara, on the other hand, together with Stitches and the Slow plus Wolves on, well, Rhaegar's Totem and Thrall with his Wolves can be super annoying. And if you get a good hook in against Zagara, against, like, Falstad, and I guess to a certain extent against Sonya as well, you can really start to, like, pressure these targets and take them away. So, I'm very eager to see how the Sandwich Monkeys are going to play that right now. Keep in mind, they are already in the 1-0 lead, so if they're able to win game number 2, then they are the ZOTAC Cup Monthly Champions, and they would take the Special 3 Series with a 2-0. So guys, let's jump in and check out which team is going to take it here. Game number 2, everybody, in the best of 3 series with a 1-0 lead for the Sandwich Monkeys here at the ZOTAC Cup Monthly Final. The best of 3, the lead for the Sandwich Monkeys, means of course that this could also be the last map, Tomb of the Spider Queen. And to the left side we have Epsilon with Stalk on Johanna, Sphyxie on Falstad, Andileni on Zagara, Unstable on Karazim, and Steer on Sonya. To the right side of the map, we have that combo again with Stitches and Lunara. Anti-hero on Lunara, actually. And BKB on Stitches, with Zarmani falling into the Thrall role now. We have Sport Billy on Rhaegar and ADRD on Tassadar. So it's already a bit surprising to me that we see actually Anti-hero on Lunara here, trying to bounce a little bit on Bambi, whereas at the same time his Thrall got taken away from him, more or less. So that's an interesting touch. We have already on level 1 a few adjustments here with the talents, and whoa! Andilendi is blown to pieces! Yeah, well, that was a very aggressive start into the game, and I mean, if you get too close to Bambi, then she is definitely going to be able to take you on here. Level 1 talent with a natural perspective, so you get the reveal. It's basically like two things that you can do. First of all, you're having, of course, like either if you're trying to like push a little bit against minions and mercenaries, and in this case, it's just like a vision aspect. Electric charge also taken. So we've been talking a bit about the potential totem build on the side of Rhaegar once again to also then use level 16 to lock targets after hook down a bit more. But this is a completely different approach now, going into something that will help BKB at the front line with the lightning shield. Not really so typical to see the lightning shield still taken here. Usually when you look at most players, they are going away from it and starting to go into a totem build with healing totem even or healing ward on level 4 occasionally. Hook again, BKB getting it in against Falstad and trying to put the pressure in. So we have a couple of adjustments over the style that we kind of expected here, but it's still so far working out in the early game. Also, we have now Warpaint taken for Sonya, which is of course another adjustment, but Epsilon is not willing to give this up quite that easily. They are starting to jump in and attempt to pressure away with that Condemn on especially Johanna. Of course, they can just like suck the targets in. We have on level 1 also the Gathering Storm used. Sphyxie with that build that has become a bit more popular after the latest patch. Blizzard making sure that they open up other builds for Falstad and not only the auto attack build. So right now it's actually a completely different setup that we oftentimes see on Falstad. We've seen this build already before today. He's just trying to stack the damage after this. Yeah, here comes the hook attempt again, but Sphyxie is able to dodge it. BKBO, of course, trying to like hit that up to the top. For now, the hook is still definitely one of the scarier things here. And with the Hungry for More as a level 1 talent, the rotation is definitely benefiting Stitches the most, together with heroes like, of course, Tassadar, who are relying on the Conjurer's Pursuit to get their mana pool up. In this case, we have still a Slam hybrid for Stitches. So this is one of the things that you see a little bit more often these days, that on level 1 you will still go for Hungry for More if you are the solo tank on your team, then in particular, and then you start to go into the Slam talents instead. And this is actually something that can go as far as them heading into a different level 16 talent, not trying to use the fishing hook, but instead going straight for the slow there. So it's going to depend a bit on how exactly they want to play. With the double support that we're currently seeing here, we have already Tassadar at the bot lane trying to help out Thrall, so the rotation up at the top is now with only 3, and again that hook! I mean, it's just nice damage that Anti-Hero gets out. He's poking the entire time from a distance. The bot lane was pressured back. Zarmani had a bit of help here, of course, as we already said. And in the mid lane right now, Sport Billy and ADRD are also doing fairly well. At the top lane, on the other hand, you can really tell that we have another great hook. And in this case, there's the lockdown. Anti-Hero wants the kill. Doesn't get it yet, but so much damage. Anti-Hero is really getting incredible damage in here already. Healing Totem on level 4 has been taken. So we have that now in play as well. Nice poke with the right, the Lightning and Rolling Thunder, a 2. And just, I mean, usually I don't really see any reason to show the damage in the early game, but just like take a closer look at Lunara. She's at 12,000. 12,000. She's getting shielded the entire time, and she's just in the back, just poking. Antira is just poking, 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 a little bit away, and he already dished out 12,000 damage. And he's not stopping. He's always keeping himself safe, away from the rest, making sure that nobody can get close to him, and he just whittles the hit points of the opponents down, and it's working incredibly well for him. So this is one of those things that Bambi is going to try to do over the entire duration of the game. And as long as Stitch is at the front line, has such a high hit point pool, and can just like soak away a little bit, it's going to work perfectly for them. They're relying on one heavy range damage dealer, and everybody else is just dishing out the damage at the front line. 16,000 damage. Zagara herself has only 9k at this point. Great play by Lunara. And well, the level 7 talents are also coming in now very soon. And of course, one of the things that that does, it pushes you back. It first of all drains, especially like the mana on the support, so that he has to go back at some point and needs to recharge. And also, it makes sure that the entire rotation between mid and top is a lot less healthy, because everybody is just so low and anti-hero gets that damage in. Once again, Iron Skin being used, just a couple of pokes, moving back. So the input at the turning points, 40 against 6. That what has been turned in so far quite easily, because the red team is doing such a great job with this. Tenderizer still taken on level 7, by the way, for Stitches. Here come the Web Weaver waves, and we're seeing also now the cooldown reduction going straight into the Blood and Thunder. No cleanse needed in this case, and cooldown reduction is amazing on that hero. Rhaegar is such an incredible tool already, but if you get that great cooldown reduction here, then you can just like spam out your abilities, and that is something that he is looking forward to. So we have again also now the boomerang taken. So once more, this ability build, Power Throw, Gathering Storm, and Boomerang have been claimed. In the middle of the map, the defense against the Web Weavers has started, but Antir is jumping in again. And Shir can't turn around, dodges the hook though, but he can't go for Lunara here. He can't go simply for that spear, and Lunara is just like going for it the entire time. They try to go for BKB, but he's already in a pretty sweet spot here as well. And BKB at this point already 15 stacks on his Hungry for More, so a nice hit point boost that he gets here. Unstable, look how low he already is. He needs to move away, he can't really stay there. He needs to move in, gets a quick heal, moves out again, but Lunara isn't even with him. She's up at the top lane, trying to threaten Falstad a little bit. Thrall at the bottom of the map has already dealt with Zagara. Nice, here comes the Rude. He's trying to go for the kill. Can't really lock her down just yet though. 25 gems on her part at the top lane. Yeah, a bit of damage against the towers, but nothing really forced yet. The structures have more destroyed in the mid lane. So the early Web Weaver wave, of course, still the weakest one, but they were able to get some experience out of it. The problem for the Sandwich Monkeys is that they didn't really force too much. They're only slightly ahead in experience here, so that is a bit of an issue. Lunara went into the Vile Vigor here, and we're seeing at the same time now also an attempt up at the top lane to go for Sphyxie. He's incredibly low already. Sphyxie being attacked, barrels away, hook against Karazim, but there was nobody else to really capitalize on the fact that Falstad was a bit out of position. At the bot lane, still Thrall against Zagara, and this time he's actually trying to go for it. Already Spot Billy is ready, but the rotation of Epsilon is needed. Level 10 is what we are currently seeing both teams aim for. 87, 88 gems against 47 at this point, and Antiro poking from a distance again. The problem, of course, that you have with Lunara and all the damage is you still need a finisher. You need someone to really finish the kill. We have seen games where especially Lunara had absolutely incredible damage, but it never translated into kills. And that is something where Thrall comes into play. Thrall needs to be the one to lock a target down and really obliterate it. Be it with a Sundering or just locking it down with a Wolf, it doesn't really matter too much. They're already trying to do that here at the bottom of the map. Both of the teams now with the level 10 abilities, and we have the Thornwood Mines as expected. We are seeing Mighty Gust taken over the Hinterland Blast, which has been used in earlier games now. Here comes again the go for Spot Beat in this case, but look at Sphyxie, how low he already is. Here come the Thornwood Mines, and Antiro with all the damage. Pop! Triggered already. They go for Steer, Mighty Gust used, and Antiro has to move away. Again, no kill. The only kill that we've seen in this game was the first kill against Zagara. And look at the damage output. 27,000 already for Lunara. 20,000 for Zagara. The Red Web Weavers are descending again though. with all of that pressure play that we see in the middle of the map, the red team, the Sandwich Monkeys, they have been able to really establish dominance here so far. But at the bot lane, they're of course now aiming for structures. They need to finally make something happen with those turn-ins that they get, and it needs to happen sooner rather than later. At the top lane, Lunara has to be careful. Sport Billy is there as well. Yeah, already moving away. Needs to be very careful, actually. Webweavers are there, and so far they have been defended. But the bot lane and the mid lane, that is where the party really starts. Yeah, especially over here. Lunara is starting to move in again. Thornwood Vines everywhere. Nice damage. Budric Bile used as well. Stitches with a poison. So much poison here. Now all of a sudden, Stalk is about to fall. Palmed, on the other hand. Undylendi is low. Thornwood Vines being used. Undylendi is getting healed. Everybody is so low, but they can't finish them off. They cannot finish them. They just can't get the kills in. And this must be so frustrating right now. But they have the momentum. And that helps. The momentum carries them towards the left side now. And they are starting to take the structures down. The first fort has been eliminated. Down to the bottom of the map. The Webweaver is already pressuring fort number two. And Unstable has to react. But that also means that up at the top lane, Stier is falling. Finally, the gems. They try to go. And they get him. Undylendi is there. He gets the gems. But they got the double kill. And now they can just like move back. They dove deep for those kills. And they want to get the fort, of course, and they are going to get it right now. So job well done, actually. Once again, level 13 is very close. And more than 100 gems are now on the side of Team Epsilon. The Sandwich Monkeys, well, they still have 20 that they could turn in. And they are starting to move down to the bottom of the map. Undylendi has 70 gems at this point. Nice cleanse here. Well done by Unstable. Making sure that Undylendi was not taken apart. Level 13 at this point. That cleanse was important, by the way. Like, if Zagara dies with those 77 gems, then it's basically lights out. We have the unfair advantage now taken, and we have also now the Mega Smash. So, just like smashing away the entire time with the tidal waves now. And right now, you can really tell that getting control of the mid lane is very, very tough for Epsilon. But they are trying to do that. Here comes again Undylendi. Sport Billy had to go deep to actually interrupt him, but now everybody else can move in and help out. So they take control again with the extra talent, which helps them a lot, especially since they're currently running Giant Killer. Tide Waves is a massive power spike in 16 already. Especially, of course, with the unfair advantage on the power. She is so safe in the backline. It's actually a little bit sad that we don't have a tab that shows how much damage Lunara has taken, because I can tell you that that number is going to be very low. The zone that we see from BKB in particular is incredible. Like, he's always at the front zoning. He's currently at 800 extra health hit points thanks to the 28 stacks that he already has on the Hungry for More. So that is quite a bit. We are seeing, again, Stitches going very, very deep here, actually. Stier is there. Yeah, Putrid Bile is being used. The more, and nice Sundering here. The Sundering is great. The kill against Zagara. They're trying to protect the gems. That 77 that they just lost. So many of them. Oh, the hook against Sonya. That's 50 gems right there. If she dies, and she falls down to 40 gems. An incredible amount that they just lost, and we're not done yet. Once again, they're jumping. It was Karazim, by the way, that fell. Sonya is dying too, but a bit delayed here. Karazim killed first. Sonya dying now too. 35 gems only. Unbelievable. The Sandwich Monkeys, they absolutely play this as perfect as you can. This doesn't get any better. BKB's hooks are crazy good at this point. His zoning for his backline is out of this world. Lunara can do whatever she wants. This is Anti-Hero's easiest game. He just hops around a little bit and kills people. And that's all that he does. BKB with all the work right now. Just look at that damage output. 37,000 already on Lunara. We're still seeing Stitches with solid 28k. I mean, 28,000, that's more damage than Thrall has been able to dish out. Just to give you a few pointers here. So it's really working out for them. And of course they're going to try and turn it again. They're only 4 gems short and then they can get another turn in. At the same time, we're having also now Epsilon in a position where they are going for a turn in as well. And they finally need to make some play because they have level 13 now. But Unstable is low again, needs to move away. He can't go deep. Sarmony gets healed. Sundering is there. Now they can go for the kill against maybe Stür. Stür is low. Stür is palmed. Not falling though. It's not triggered. The palm isn't triggered. BKB is in the middle of things again. Look at that force wall. Double kill. They could go for the triple and they get it. Oh my god. Look at all of those gems. Everything's lost. Everything. They lost all of the gems except for 4. This is a disaster for Epsilon. Level 16 right now and they even go for boss. 9 kills against 0. The Sandwich Monkeys. Why the hell do these guys disband? What the... It is absolute... nothing annoys me more these days than the thought that they are actually disbanding. This is just crazy. This team is playing so well that the fact that they didn't qualify for Katowice is just absolutely... That's just insane. It's just insane. I don't know how that happened. ADRD and his boys, they are once again in a position where they can turn in again. They have a level 16 talent that they can easily use right now. Boss has been timed up to the top as well. And this is a disaster for Epsilon. Like, right now, for them to start a comeback, they need to get a team wipe somehow. And I just don't know how it could work. With a great Maw and a good Gust, maybe. But it's very unlikely. Well, we have Stitches starting to move in now as well. And of course, let's take another look at also the numbers here at this point. I mean, looking at the numbers, Stitches with 51,000 damage tanked so far. We are seeing them again going straight for the kills here. Already Force Wall trying to isolate Unstable, but he dashed away the hook against the hook and the lockdown. Stier with the palm, palm not triggered. He's incredibly low. BKB is isolated though. BKB, finally they get a kill. Finally they get a kill. Ancestral healing was not used because Sport Billy was caught in the Maw. That's the setup that we need from Epsilon for them to start a comeback here. A 5 versus 4 situation, but of course the fate is already decided of this team. It falls and they might actually be able to even get a kill in. Nope, Stern unstable, they both escape. Karazhan is able to heal them up again. The big problem here once again that they don't have the finisher in this case. They have to rely on Thrall for that, and since already Stitches is out of commission and is down, they just can do as much as possible with the few heroes that they have. They can't dive too deep. If they do that, then they overextend too much. And level 16 talents are, by the way, now ready. Level 16 is ready, and they can't overstay. At this point, we have now Mutalisk and Brood expansion. Here comes at the same time Johanna moving in. Everybody else is rushing away. And the big problem, of course, is that we still don't have a single fort taken out. Epsilon hasn't killed a fort. They haven't killed a single one. They weren't able to get one. They lost the keep at the top lane. They lost the wall at the bottom, the wall in the middle. Like, they are losing structures all over the place. Tazada is saying hi down here. They're starting to move in again. A little bit of a bait, apparently. Stork is very far out. Needs to be careful. Thornwood Vines are missing him, but the hook doesn't. He uses his Ironskin a little bit too late, and Stork is about to kiss the world goodbye if he doesn't pay attention. Stür is trying to move in. They go again for BKB, but the kill against... Nope, there's the pop. Johanna nearly falling, but Stier, Bambi is down. Bambi down, and that could be a problem for them. But they still have some damage. There goes the kill against Stitches. Well played. And still Stier alive. Unstable keeps him alive. The double kill. 16 versus 16 talents. Maybe Epsilon with a bit of a comeback. Can they make it happen? They are already starting to use the poke against Fixie to make sure that he doesn't jump in and try to gust them, because Gust was still ready. Three heroes moving away and still a level lead. 9 kills against 3. Once that Lunara is dead, most of your damage is gone. That's a big problem. This time, actually, anti-hero not as perfectly positioned as he was before. Sonya had a shot at him and took it. Sonya took the shot, took down Lunara, and with that, most of the damage was gone. They could start to collapse on Stitches, and that's what they did. And with both of them out, there was just no way. The turn-in attempt, again. They're trying to turn in again, but ADRD is currently attempting to just delay that for as long as he can. Sport Billy is moving in too. And can they take down Rhaegar? Oh, what was that? The Force Wall of ADRD. Oh, trapping Rhaegar, and now he's down. They are starting to end up in that vicious circle where they're always one hero down. They just have Lunara and Stitches back, and now they lose Rhaegar. And without the healer, they can't do anything. So they are going to go up against the Webweavers. And right now, it's 18 versus 18. The Sandwich Monkeys, they go in with Sundering. They are trying to actually make a play here with a 5 versus 4. They need to be careful. That's 29 seconds until Rhaegar is going to be back. And as you can see, all of a sudden, Epsilon sees that they still have an opportunity here. They lost a lot. They lost a ton, actually. But they're still in a position where they can make some plays here. Of course, creep tumors have been taken out, or have to be taken out at this point. But down to the bot lane, a defense has started. Rhaegar is still not back just yet. Giving a bit of an update on the damage. Yeah, we have currently Falls around 45,000, 52,000 for Zagara. They're starting to make their plays here. Here comes Stier in the mid lane. They're gaining some momentum right now. Good damage, though, against Sonya. They need to be careful. Lockdown again, and they're trying to go for the kill. But anti-hero cannot finish them off. RBKB defended the bot lane for a long, long time. Now he's trying to go for the hook. Great reaction by Sfixi, moving away as fast as he can up at the top lane. The chase is already on. They're trying to buy some or to create some space so that they can deal with the Webweavers. They took the first one down. The experience lead is still there for the Sandwich Monkeys. Bot lane is going to fall very soon on the other hand. And once the fort is down, it's a bit of a different story. AD already is there. They're going for the slow. They're trying to get their horns on Johanna. Not happening just yet, though. But keep this fort in mind. It's down. Look at the experience. It's nearly the same. Once again, the attempt to go up to the top now to maybe get a kill in this fight. This is an important one. One keep is already down. Hook again thrown out, but Sfixi dashes away. And at this point, it's still 9 kills against 4. All of the heroics are up. Also the Wrath of the Berserker. And Sonya could... there's especially Sonya going for the heroic again. The poke. Anti-hero is poking from a distance. This time he commits. He's trying to go for the kill. She has to be careful. Nice Mighty Gust. They are trying to jump on BKB. No chance there. And still, the Maw is there. But also, Palm has not been triggered yet. Palm has not been triggered. Stark and Brother and Sunder Ring being used. And they go for Johanna. Johanna gets palmed and is saved. The kill against Thrall. And Epsilon is starting to turn a game around that looked lost. Here comes again the damage. The poke. But who is going to finish the kills? Who is going to jump in to finish the kill off? The damage output, still 80,000 hero damage on Lunara, but they need a finisher in these cases. The heal, on the other hand, on Karazim is nearly at 100,000 already. Karazim is nearly at 100,000 heal at this point. Level 20 is also in play here once again, of course. The kill for Stork! Stork! Oh, and his, yeah, he triggers his invincible. Oh my god, like indestructible, sorry, indestructible is getting triggered here. Epic Mount also being used. Thrall is not back yet, but soon TM. We are also seeing the Peaceful Repose. Of course, Karazim can throw that out, and it's actually a great talent if you think about it. Against Lunara in this case, it's a perfect talent, because you never know when that poison is actually going to finish someone off or when there's going to be a final blow. Andy Lendi is a bit isolated, but AD Ardy is very low himself. He needs to be super careful here. He went, by the way, on level 20 into the Force Barrier. Rega with a rewind. Uh-oh, BKB! Lockdown and dead. Rega not with the team at this point. His ancestor was also on cooldown. Epsilon is really starting to make the plays here. And they have another turn in. They have another turn in right now. And a 5 versus 3, you can't fight that. Thrall is back to business. They try to poke. They poke as much as they can. But Stork is zoning for the rest of the team. What a game. What a second game. It looked like it was over. It really looked like it was GG. A massive lead. The first keep falling. Boss taken. And then maybe the Sandwich Monkeys a bit too confident here. They have to wait for Stitches. No Stitches, no competition. Like, they need someone at the front line. They don't have that. Zarmany is there. They will have to move back and wait for him. They can't overextend here. If they get jumped by anybody, then it is lights out. They cannot keep this up with this vicious cycle always falling behind the hero. It's a death spiral, and they cannot afford it at this point. They will have to sacrifice the fort. Yes, Stitches back into AD. Ardy is toying with fire here. He needs to be careful, and he moves away. Gets away for now. Here comes Stitches. Stitches is back to business. Stitches wants to play. He's here. He hooks, and he misses. At the same time now, though, Stier is starting to dart in again. Top lane, there's still a fort available. So far, it's still that keep. It's still a keep that they have, and the Web Weaver here is going to be eliminated. So, guys, we have momentum for Epsilon. Yes, that's definitely true, but keep in mind that when we're talking about advantages, we are still seeing the better situation for them here. Ancestral healing is being used. Stork is low. Stork is low. Here's the palm. Here comes the Sundering. They're trying to go for the kill, this time against Stier. Anti-heroes darting in, jumping, trying to get a kill, but immediately the Gust. Great play by Falstead. That was exactly what they needed. Panic button, boom, disengage, right away. The keep has not fallen, so it's still the better situation, the better position in this game now for the team in red. The Sandwich Monkeys, if they want to win this, they really have to take a bit of a breather right now. They have to make sure that they take a bit of a breather and just, like, calm down. Andy Lendi and Sfixi in the mid lane already. Great position here currently for Epsilon. They have a lot of momentum, and if they can keep that up, then they might be able to turn it around. But the situation is still better for the Sandwich Monkeys. The map control, of course, largely in the hands now on the side of Epsilon, thanks to especially Andy Lendi. But most of the creep tumors are now about to be taken down, and once that happens, vision is going to be diminished. Antihero is poking as much as he can, and we're seeing again down here everybody else just like collapsing into the middle, trying to get that turn in. They have 61 of 65 gems that they need, so they're very close. A lot of sustain thanks to the double support setup here. IDRD far out, and of course there's also like another camp to take into consideration. Antihero with a poke. Look at that damage against Stür. He gets healed though. He gets healed the entire time, but where is that peaceful repose? Do they go for it? Oh, this attempted kill, but they can't get it. Stalk on the other hand, they're gonna trigger it again. They're gonna trigger the indestructible, aren't they? No, they're not. Unstable is there. Unstable is there. Heals him. Do we have another hook? No, but we have a turn in now. So, slowly and steadily, the Sandwich Monkeys are starting to take control over the game again. They get their turn in, they will get a Webweaver wave, and well, the lanes have been pushed out pretty much, but right now that could definitely help them to maybe drop another keep, especially one of the bot lane is very low. The problem with that, of course, is that the wave is the lane is really pushed back. Over here on the other hand, another hook against Stalk. They're trying to go for the kill once more. Antihero, it's really key that he stays alive. If he dies, it's over. Then they have no damage to really take a target down. Andy Lendi jumping away here with the Bolt of the Storm. He escapes in the last moment. Quick damage check here, 120,000 damage already on Lunara. Nobody's even close. Look at the heals on Karazim, 140,000. That's how much he's been able to heal with his setup that he has right now. Absolutely out of this world. Here comes that hook again, but immediately the iron skin. They start to pressure the lane heavily, and they want to go for the keep, and they really start to put the pressure in, and the Webweaver, yeah, they're going to get this. Keep number two is going to fall. Keep number two is going to fall. Keep the top lane in mind also. Top lane still pressured. The keep's already gone, and that means the Webweaver has an easy time pushing that through and going straight for the core. Second keep is down. Here comes the attack. Antihero in the back line, still with the poke. Lunara so safe. I'm loving the way that he's playing this. BKB and Antihero, definitely the two that everything hinges on right now. And BKB at the front is doing an incredible job. Again, the hook. They go for Stalk. And can they trigger it? Antihero is there. Goes for the attack. Stalk is low, very low. So is Stier. They're trying to go for the kill here. Here comes the Sundering. But they cannot finish it. And immediately the Maw. Maw against three. And do they get away? Ancestral healing is through. Zarmaninho jumps in, takes out Falset. He dies himself though. Four versus four. Andy Lendi with the palm. The palm has been triggered. But they're trying to go for Stier. Maybe this is the chance. Maybe the chance. The core is already under attack, down to 80%, and the Sandwich Monks are going for the kill at the same time. We have Karazim already dying, and immediately it's Sonya. Sonya that they try to go for. Antihero is trying to drop her. He can't, but they drop Sagara. They go for core, and ladies and gentlemen, it looks like they're going to make it, but it's not over just yet. Stalk is fighting 30% on the core. They're trying to drop it, and they will be able to. Down goes Rekha, but it doesn't matter. GG, well played, the Sandwich Monkeys with a 2-0 victory. What a final map, Ma. Oh my god, what a game. GG and well played.
And that, ladies and gentlemen, is GG and the end of another series here on KhaldorTV with Heroes of the Storm. So once again, we have another video finished, and I hope that you enjoyed the commentary and that you liked the game, of course, as well. It was a pleasure casting the match for you. And if you guys really enjoyed it, then make sure that you give that video a thumbs up on YouTube. And of course, if you haven't subscribed to the channel yet, feel free to do that too. If you have friends that are interested in Heroes of the Sports esports scene, then definitely recommend the channel to them or just show them the video if they want to see like a bit how the pros are drafting here, especially, of course, when it comes to the North American scene, European scene. And I mean, these days, we even have a couple of Chinese games on the channel here, so I hope that you enjoy that as well. That being said, thank you very much for watching again. I'm going to see you guys next time with more Heroes of the Storm content here on the channel. Have a great day and enjoy your week, and see you soon. Bye bye.